This morning we're going to be looking at Matthew 23, verses 13 through 15. Last week, we looked at the entirety of Matthew 23, most of it, and the point of looking at that was to see an overview of Christ's judgment, and we saw Jesus as a lion roaring, prophetically bringing out judgment against the scribes and the Pharisees. We'll not be able to spend much time reviewing that sermon this morning for our time's sake. But remember the scribes and Pharisees, these are the religious leaders. They are those in the temple. Why scribes and Pharisees? Well, scribes are the teachers of the law. The Pharisees is the religious group of the law. So scribe is kind of the teachers of Pharisaism. So that's why they're together. It really is used kind of poetically, scribes and Pharisees, to simply be implicatory of the entirety of the religious system and how it had become in Judaism. We are going to break this up, and I'm going to have to kind of just explain a little bit of what I'm doing so that you can follow me. I'm afraid you might not be able to follow me if I don't do this. Last week we looked at Matthew 23, the entire chapter, to understand the idea of Jesus as a judge, Jesus as a roaring lion, that he is not like many picture him. He is not like many portray him. Today, kind of a soft Jesus, pretty much cool with anything that we might do or think. He is a lion who roars in judgment. And this week we're going to look at verses 13 through 15 because in his judgment he outlines 8 different woes or calls out of judgment. The woe there is a very strong form of judgment and it means basically damnation. And so there's 8 different ones that he describes, 8 different causes or 8 different woes of judgment against the scribes and Pharisees. In studying this, I came to see the first woe as being a summary of all the judgment and the last woe of being a summary of all the judgment. And then each of the ones in between being able to be divided in pairs. So woe 2 and 3, 4 and 5, and 6 and 7 kind of fitting in those couplet patterns. Now this is a very much a Hebrew way of teaching to have the first and the last introduction, conclusion, and then couplets in between. Psalms does it all the time. Proverbs does it all the time. Those teaching methods. And so Jesus is employing a very rabbinical style, rabbi style of teaching. And we wanted to look at those. I'm going to divide them up into doing a sermon on each of the pairs of woes. Today we'll look at 3 because we're going to look at the introductory woe briefly. And then look at the next 2, the first pair of woes against the scribes and Pharisees. Next week we'll look at the second pair, the 4th and 5th woes. And what's funny is that the first pair takes 2 verses. And the next pair takes several verses to describe it. He explains it in a lot more detail. The reason why I'm doing this in pairs is because each one is saying essentially the same thing. Each part of the pair is saying essentially the same thing, same concept. But because we have Easter Sunday coming up, we are going to take a break right in the middle. This is getting kind of confusing, I know. Take a break right in the middle, and we are going to do a short study on the book of Romans chapter 6. And in fact, that's going to take us 3 Sundays to do that. Dividing Romans 6 up into 3 different sermons. Then we'll come back and finish the last set of woes and then the final concluding thoughts of Matthew 23. Now, what you'll find is that even though we're taking a break on the judgments to talk about the resurrection and new life in Christ, I think what you'll discover is that Romans 6 actually fits well with this topic in Matthew 23. That it will not be hard to follow and see a theme in our sermons. So Matthew chapter 23 verses 13 through 15, the introductory woe in verse 14, and then the 2 woes in verse 13-15. In a moment I'll tell you why that is. But read with me, look in the Bible. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. Therefore you will receive the greater condemnation. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, and when he is won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. Spirit of God, help us in your word, that you would illuminate this text to us. You would encourage us with it, you would challenge us, and you would wake us up with it. Lord, we pray that you would help us to be receptive to your word today, and that we'd be reverential toward it as well. Help us to learn of the glorious Christ from your scripture. In his name we pray, amen. What is religion? Scribes and Pharisees, we were religious. And I think there's been a mistake amongst many evangelical and fundamental Christians in kind of turning the word religion into a bad word. It's not a bad word. Trendy sayings that you might have heard, you might have said, I love Christ but hate religion, or Christianity is a relationship, not a religion. Even though innocently quoted as a defense of salvation in Christ alone, I believe are actually an error because they create a false dichotomy between Christ, Christianity, and religion. See, defining the word religion is easy. Religion is simply adherence to a particular system of faith and worship. It's actually, from the Latin word we get religion from, it means devotion, obligation, reverence. Now, think about that for just a minute. Are those not all good things? In fact, are not all those things that Christ commands of us? Adherence to a system of faith, the system he's written in the word. Devotion, obligation, reverence. I mean, did not Jesus say that man must hate everything and follow him? Did not Jesus say that we must deny ourselves, follow him, obligation, that we owe him our lives? Paul says in Romans 12, we have a great debt, we are debtors to mercy. So the idea of religion is not in and of itself a bad thing. God himself created the Jewish religion for a particular time and place, namely to bring about the focus of true religion. Jesus Christ is the true religion. And he commands all people to follow him with devotion, obligation, reverence. Indeed, to follow Christ religiously, we could even say. Indeed, the Christian faith or Bible religion is the belief in a particular system of faith and worship, as revealed in the Holy Bible concerning Jesus Christ. Thus, Christianity is a religion in the truest sense of the word. And so we ought to make a false dichotomy that we so easily do. When we use the word religion always in a negative context, I think we actually are inadvertently contributing to a low view of commitment and devotion to Christ. When we say those phrases, well, Christianity is just a relationship, not a religion, and then we wonder why everybody says, well, it doesn't matter what I do or how I live because it's just a relationship. I'm good. I can do everything I want. I have a relationship with Jesus. I said a prayer. I think we kind of contribute to that with those kind of hallmark phrases, trendy catchphrases. Be careful. Really, we cannot take the truth of God's word and boil it down to a nice little poem, a nice little saying. It just doesn't work that way. No, this sermon is actually not going to be about defending the use of the English word religion. But it is important to understand that we cannot place the idea of religion in opposition with Christ, just as we ought not place the idea of good works in opposition to faith. The Apostle James argues strongly about that. See, it's not that it's faith or good works. And James argues, no, it's faith producing good works. And the reality is, it's the same thing. It's not relationship with Christ or religion, but a relationship with Christ, with God through Christ, produces what James himself calls pure religion, true religion. And he describes that as external. He describes it as visiting fatherless and widows in their affliction, keeping oneself impure and unspotted from the world. So he's describing external things as pure religion that flow from faith in Christ. So it's not about one versus the other. It's about what produces the other, or what comes first, or what makes the other one possible. Does that make sense? Christ's relationship, a relationship with God, makes true or pure religion, as the Bible describes it, possible. James was not saying that religion can bring us to God. He was saying that God, Christ, brings us to true religion. There's a difference there. Thus, a proper definition of biblical religion is external holiness, reverence, and worship that flows from a faithful relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Now, all that relates to our Bible text how? Matthew 23:13-15, Jesus is not, as some have suggested, attacking the idea of religion here. Rather, he's pointing out that their practice, the scribes and Pharisees' practice of the Jewish religion as interpreted through their Pharisaical theological grid, was eternally destructive to them and to all who follow them. He's not attacking religion per se. He is attacking quite forcefully mere religion that does not flow from genuine faith in Christ. The merely religious, as opposed to the pure religion that flows from faith in Christ. See, there have been, and really are, only two religions in the world. What I would call mere religion, man's religion, and what the Bible calls pure religion. And I'm not talking about churches or structures. I'm talking about devotion or worship, way of thinking, faith. Because this mere religion, this man's religion, has many, many names and many different buildings and many different structures and styles all over the world. But it's essentially the same. Mere religion teaches that people can somehow, through things they do or don't do, bring themselves into God or God, their God's favor. In all religions, mere religions of man teach that in one way or another. Judaism was a religion whereby God's people were to do religious things as evidence that God was gracious and merciful to them in promising to save them from their sin. But the Pharisees had perverted the Old Testament Judaism so that these religious acts were now to them, and they were teaching the means by which people, sinners, could earn God's favor, God's grace upon them as individuals and as a people, as a nation. And so many of the things the Pharisees did were good. Many of those things were intended to be a show or demonstration of God's grace, like the sacrifices, the feast days. But see, they had perverted, they had taken those things that God had given them to be evidences of God's grace, and they had made them to be the means to get God's grace, to make themselves righteous with these things. And that's the same with all mere religions. So Jesus begins these prophetic and serious pronouncements against the mere religion of the Pharisees. He's careful to point out, though, here in the first pair, the central and most important deficit in their mere religion and these religious leaders. And this most important deficit in their mere religion is the most important deficit in all of man's religions. And that is their rejection of Christ alone as the only means to know the grace and favor of God's kingdom. As in Jesus' day, so today, religions of all kind promise much, provide a little temporary satisfaction perhaps, but ultimately lead people away from eternal life and joy with God, because mere religion leads people to find the solution to their lostness in themselves. What they can do or not do, their religious doing, or religious leaders, rather than the solution for my lostness in a gracious relationship with God through Jesus Christ alone and what He does and is doing. Now, I read this morning verses 13 through 15. The pair of woes is actually verse 13 and 15. 14 is the introductory one. We talked about this last week, and it is true that this verse, verse 14, some Greek manuscripts do not contain it, others do, and so different translations will treat this differently. We do know that Jesus said it, because Mark and Luke both have verse 14 in their account. And actually, both Mark and Luke use verse 14 as the summary of the whole thing. So verse 14 actually is the summary. Mark and Luke reckon is the summary of it, because it kind of explains everything else we need to know about what Jesus is going to get into the details about. Now, why does it come as 14 and not 13 and 15 together? Well, that's another one of the interesting things. Well, interests me anyways. Different manuscripts have it in different orders. The Byzantine manuscript, which is probably my favorite Greek manuscript to study, has it as verse 13. And we see that here it's reflected as verse 14. Either way, I just want you to know, I'm going to be teaching verse 14 first and then 13 and 15 together. I think contextually you'll see why that is the case. And we notice it is clear by Jesus in all these verses, but specifically in verse 14, it is clear by Jesus often repeating the accusation of hypocrite, that religious hypocrisy is a central part of man's religion, and that God is deeply offended by religious hypocrisy. I mean, he says it in seven of the eight woes. Hypocrite, hypocrite, hypocrite. It is no accident that in his opening call of judgment, in the summary statement, it's really about their hypocrisy. He says this, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. Therefore you will receive greater condemnation." Though they make long prayers, and Jesus indicates clearly it's not the length of prayers he's talking about that's a problem. He speaks of the pretentious nature of their long prayers. But that it's only a show for holiness or piety. Charles Spurgeon said this, "True prayer is measured by weight, not by length. A single groan before God may have more fullness of prayer in it than fine oration of great length." But I kind of like the way George Whitefield said it. He said this concerning a preacher who stood in public prayer before he preached. Whitefield, the famous evangelist, said, "He prayed me into a good frame of mind. And if he had stopped there, it would have been very well. But he prayed me out of it again by keeping on." This is not the first time here that Jesus had exposed the pretentious prayers of the Pharisees, right? In another place, he calls out the Pharisee who stands in the public marketplace, praising himself and saying, "I thank God that I am not a sinner like this tax collector," for everyone to hear. And then Jesus praises the tax collector who stood off to the side and would not look toward heaven, but smote his breast and said, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." So not the first time he's called out the pretentious prayers of the Pharisees. Every religion, even pure religion, even biblical religion, Christianity, puts emphasis on authenticity in prayer as opposed to pretentious praying. But it's not actually that Jesus is actually teaching about prayer here, a lesson on prayer, whether we pray long or short, or whether we make sure we have the right motives, though that is clearly the problem here, because his point in this opening woe is to point out the great disparity between their public show and their lifestyle. On Sabbath, they stand and make pretentious long prayers, and the rest of the week, they foreclose on the widows' houses. They take what they can from the most vulnerable in the society. And he's using very clear hyperbole here. Now, I'm not saying it's not literal that they didn't foreclose. I mean, he's trying to show like great disparaging difference, right? I mean, who would do this? Who would stand on the Sabbath and pray these long prayers while destroying a widow with barely 2 cents to rub together? With no mercy, no compassion, no goodness in them, that even the wicked pagans would take care of their own. Who would do this? And this is the hyperbole he's giving. He's wanting the people he's warning, the disciples and would-be disciples, to see these Pharisees for what they really are. They're vultures. Thus, this first woe stands as a summary indictment through the rest of the woes, as laying out the evil and hypocritical hearts of the merely religious. See, one can cover depravity up with much religious decoration, but God sees the heart of the religious, and it is bankrupt before him as anyone's heart. Hypocrisy can fool many people, and this is a simple saying, but it's true, but God is never fooled. And then he moves on to the first pair of woes, verse 13 and 15, the Byzantine text, they go together. The charge of religious hypocrisy is serious, but the solution is not simply, okay, then be more sincere. In other words, it's not simply enough to say, so that they just, well, then they should not have pretentious prayers, just pray. I mean, just stop eating the widow's houses up. Just be more authentic, be more sincere, and everything will be fine. No, my friends, the Pharisees would not have been fine if they'd just been sincere in their error. Sincerity alone is not enough to make one's religion pure and true. True religion, the biblical Christianity, is concerned primarily with truthfulness and accuracy, even above sincerity. And so in the first pair of woes, Jesus actually moves away from the accusation of hypocrisy. He calls them hypocrites, but it's more like a title at this point. And he's not going to address the issue of hypocrisy now. So the overall thing, they're hypocrites. But now in the very first collection of woes, the detail, he's going to move away from hypocrisy and not talk about what they're hypocritical in, but in their lack of truthfulness. Their lack of accuracy, their error, their most important and serious error of all. See, it's not a charge against the Pharisaical hypocrisy, but a charge about their against their error in rejecting the Christ, thus shutting up Christ's kingdom from men. Notice the first of the two judgments in verse 13. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. When we think of kingdom of heaven, rather than thinking of place, think of rule. The idea of God's rule, God's glory, God's kingdom, his family, his righteous rule. You shut up the kingdom of heaven. You shut up God's rule. You remove people, or you keep people, men, people, from enjoying God. You keep them from his kingdom. How do they do that? For you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. The phrase, shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, literally uses words that could be read this way. You slam the door in their face. The word there before men is the word the face, before the face of men. You slam the door of God before them. You slam the door of glory. You slam the door of redemption. You slam it in their face, God's kingdom. That is, the religious leaders were leading people to the kingdom of heaven, and when they get to the people to the kingdom entrance, they stop them and then slam the promise of God's kingdom shut against them. How is this so? Because they are not able to go in. And the idea here, and this is very interesting to me, they says, you do not allow, or that's the word permit, and the idea there is willingly. You can't get in, and so you won't let anybody else in. I mean, Jesus is not just attacking the bad teaching of the Pharisees. He's attacking their motives. He's using language that seemed to imply, and you don't want them to go in. You're not willing for them to go in. Does mere religion know what its teaching is false? I think this, did the Pharisees know that they were keeping people from God's kingdom? We could probably debate that, but I think this verse implies at least some of us to consider that for just a moment. There perhaps is a knowing willingness to keep people from God, from this kingdom. How often did Jesus preach about entering the kingdom of God in heaven? How often has he been preaching that he is the king and no one will enter God's kingdom, his gracious rule, without him? I mean, that he's both the beginning and the end of the kingdom of heaven. People are starting to get it, right? And when he enters in Jerusalem on the Sunday before, all of Jerusalem, from those from Galilee as well as those in the city, are loudly praising God and Jesus Christ as the King of Kings. Remember, they were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." They were getting it. They were understanding who Jesus is, finally. It's what Jesus has been preaching through his sermons or proclaiming through his miracles for nearly 3 years. He is the King of Israel. He is the King of Kings. He is the only door of the sheepfold to God's kingdom. Deny yourself. Follow him. Forsake your life. Obey the King. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Over and over and over again, he's been teaching it. And now they're getting it. And the Pharisees now stand in the way. No. No, you can't. The religious view him as a threat to their finely crafted laws, rules, structures, and attempts to get God's attention with their religious efforts. He is the way into the kingdom, but his exclusivity, the fact that he's the only way, has offended them. It offends their pride. So they themselves are not only unable to get into God's kingdom, to receive God's grace, because they refuse Jesus Christ the King, the door to the Father. So they willingly are doing everything they can. They will not permit others to see Jesus' divinity. Did they not do this? Did they not forbid him to speak in front of the people? Did they not bring false accusations and threaten him and his disciples? They're slamming the door of God's kingdom shut in the face of the people because they refuse to acknowledge Jesus Christ the Lord as Jesus Christ alone as Lord and King. Even after his death and his resurrection, when it was reported that he'd risen, they said, "Lie! Lie! Do whatever you can!" They paid people money. They paid the soldiers money to say that somebody came and stole the body. Do we not see this, what they will not permit? This is more than just they come into error. They know they're in error, but they don't want truth. Why would somebody who knows they're in error not want truth? Well, it works for me and my family. We've been doing this for a long time. There's so much I'll lose in the community. My wife might leave me. My husband might forsake me. Many reasons can be given. But Jesus calls them out for shutting up, slamming the door of God's kingdom because they refuse the King. Verse 15 says much the same thing, but instead of pointing to their not allowing the people around them to enter the kingdom of God, there's a further judgment in their converting or proselytizing of those outside of Israel. He says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, and when he is won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves." Now, there's much debate in the history books, commentaries, about how much proselytizing the Pharisees did in the first century. Use that word, you proselytize, or you make converts. It's a rare word, only used a few times, only once here and then in Acts. Rare word used. Most likely, Jesus, the proselytizing of the Jews was not like we would think of missionary efforts in the sense of going and just telling the gospel to people. Proselytizing through the Jewish, but went through the synagogue. And so they would go and establish a synagogue where there are already Jewish peoples. We see that in Paul's travels, right? There's synagogues all over in pagan areas. And they would establish that there. And then Gentiles could become Jews by converting to Judaism. And so it wasn't the same as the missionary efforts we think. It was a little bit different, but most likely Jesus is talking about the common Jewish practice of instructing Gentile converts, like the Ethiopian eunuch in the book of Acts, or Cornelius, who was a Gentile who feared God, instructing them. They would instruct Gentile converts to Judaism to keep the whole rigors of the Torah and the Pharisaical laws in their fullness. Most important to a Pharisee, of course, was the rite of circumcision. In fact, we find in the histories that Gentiles who converted to Judaism but were not circumcised were called proselytes of the gate, implying they've come a little ways, but they're at the gate. They haven't really entered into Zion. And those who did follow through with the painful and difficult rite of circumcision as an adult were called proselytes of righteousness, meaning they'd done their whole duty. So then why does Jesus make the striking accusation that winning one proselyte, I would assume a proselyte of righteousness, they get him to follow the full rigors of the Jewish law. Why does he say that when they do so, they're making that Gentile convert twice as much a son of hell as the Pharisees themselves? I think there are two ways to understand this. I think probably both of them are correct. First, the proselytes are often more even more devout and zealous in their lawful duties than the missionaries themselves. Religious converts often go further in zeal and also in error than even those that won them in the first place, making their error greater and thus their condemnation stricter. But secondly, and I think the plainest and probably the most obvious, is those who leave everything, like a Gentile would have to leave everything and submit to the strict legalism of the Pharisees, even to the point of the circumcision, were more likely to never leave their Pharisaism, having been so firmly convinced as to make such a radical commitment. And we see this today as well. Those who go from a religion of their own making into the full-out devout zeal of a structured religion are often far more zealous than those who kind of just grew up in it. They're also far less likely to leave it. And that's what he's describing, I believe, here. They're in a worse state of condemnation because their newfound zeal for their newfound religion them has not driven them, brought them closer to the Christ. It's actually taken them farther from the Christ. Would that they had stayed a Gentile and thus perhaps been closer to hearing and believing the Christ. So the Pharisees shut up God's kingdom to those near, fellow Jews, in verse 13, and make double sons of hell from those afar, the Gentiles. Because though they are leading them to a zealous embrace of religion, they are moving them further and further from Christ alone as the true hope of entering God's kingdom found only by faith in Him. Now this is the explanation of these first woes, and it's quite striking. How do we apply this? How do we think through these things? I think first of all, we have to think through how this first pair of judgments, verse 13 and 15, would apply to the first audience. Remember, Christ is pronouncing judgment with His first purpose, not necessarily to the Pharisees directly, but as a warning to the crowds and the disciples around Him. Remember that. Thus, His first application would be to the disciples and the crowds, the would-be disciples. And this application is that legalistic religion, which is what all religions, these mere religions are, and certainly the Pharisees was, will seek to turn a sinner's gaze away from the only true solution, Jesus Christ, to their own structure. That's what it does. In the next several days, the Pharisees and teachers of the law will certainly attempt this ultimately as they bribe one of the disciples to betray Him, falsely arrest and falsely accuse Him, put Him to public shame, and a death before Jew and Gentile, both in an attempt to protect their religious cause and zeal. They'll even, as I said before, pay soldiers to lie about what appears to be a resurrection. Historically then, Jesus is perhaps being more prophetic than they understand. He's prophesying that by the impending death that he will face, and by their slandering of him and rejecting him and all the things they're doing, they will indeed be shutting the door up because they're killing the Christ. Of course, God in his infinite wisdom will use their shutting the door up to open the door to many more. Other sheep, many more. But that doesn't seem to be what he's speaking about here. He's talking about the Pharisees and their part in this. See, they'll slam the door in the faces of the people who are praising him as King this Sunday by turning their hearts away from Jesus, who came boldly, humbly, and plainly as their Lord and Savior. In fact, wasn't this the last thing that he confronted the religious leaders about? Back in Matthew 22:41, their failure to receive him as more than son of David, that he is in fact son of God. So Jesus' words ring with haunting warning to the crowds. Those who side with mere religion and reject him as the true Christ alone will become twice a son of hell, shut up to the kingdom of heaven. And the same is true today. The Pharisees do not affect us, but their doctrine is alive and well in the religions surrounding us. Any attempt to enter God's kingdom apart from simple trust in Jesus Christ alone as my right standing before God, my righteousness from God, and my hope for eternal life will make one twice a son of hell, shut up to God's kingdom. I just want to say that again clearly. Any attempt to enter God's kingdom, God's rule, God's favor, apart from simple trust in Jesus Christ alone as a right standing before God, righteousness from God, and hope for eternal life, will make that one twice a son of hell, shut up to God's kingdom. Now, many religions say that they honor Jesus Christ. How are we to know if they're like the Pharisees and they're soul damning and, you know, making him twice the son of hell or not? Or if it's pure religion? I'd give you some encouragement. Mark this well, beloved. This is primary. False religion will get some aspect of Jesus Christ wrong, whether slight or error, or great error. Could be from the belief that Christ was but one of many prophets, or that Jesus was not fully man or not fully God, that he is only a God or the offspring of God, that he is a brother of ours. Some religions would acknowledge Jesus as God eternal but err because they would suggest his work of eternal redemption is incomplete. It must be supplemented by our efforts and rituals, or that his sacrifice is being perpetually offered week after week in a religious mass. Some would not go so far, but simply diminish his power and sovereignty, suggesting that Jesus paid most of the price, but now we must prove ourselves to him. We must come through Christ, but not Christ alone. We must reach out to God with our wills ourselves. Some would say that Jesus had error, made mistakes, and only is to be trusted in as far as a good example of goodness. And some religious groups would simply ignore the truths of Jesus found in this book entirely. But make no mistake, my friends, the primary mark that a religion is not biblical but is instead man's religion, that it is a mere religion like the Pharisees, is that they will err regarding the person and work of Jesus Christ. So understand from the scripture the person and work of Jesus Christ clearly, and you can take any religion and compare it to that. Now, I'm not saying that's the only error. Nor am I saying it will always be the most obvious, but I believe you can write it down. It will be an error. And that's why Jesus deals with the error of how they viewed him, the Christ, first. This is primary. For if you get Jesus wrong, you get everything else wrong. So listen closely to what they say about Jesus. look beyond the tears and the pleas and that they love Jesus and see how they reverence his words. Notice, do they believe what Jesus said? Do they teach Jesus, his work, his sufficiency? Do they teach Christ alone? You cannot get the person or work of Jesus the King wrong and still expect to see his kingdom. My friends, the Protestant Reformation was an awakening among members, even leaders, of the most dominant religion in the world at its time. They had been following this religion and persuading others into this religion, shutting them up to the kingdom of God, making them twice the son of hell. But as they began to read God's word, and as many of these first reformers began to be awakened by the Holy Spirit to see the scriptures with freshness, one of the primary discoveries that they made was what we call the Latin phrase, solus Christus, Christ alone. That is, coming to God must be through Jesus Christ alone. And to come through Christ alone means they had better have a thorough and clear understanding of who this Jesus Christ is. Today, though there are still but two religions, mere religion and the pure biblical religion, the many different flavors have made it even more important that we are not carried about by teachers here and there, books and blogs, sermons and structures, but that we measure every religion to Christ's standard with the question, do they understand Christ plainly as he's described in the Bible, fully God, fully man? Do they teach Jesus Christ alone as the means to God and the Father and a right standing before him? Do they add anything to Jesus Christ's atonement, anything we must do in order to gain God's favor and grace? But I would add even a further warning. What if they answer all these correctly? I would still say, look deeper. What do they emphasize? There are many churches who bear Christian names that would say, oh yes, they would sign off on a doctrinal statement about Jesus Christ. But my question would be to them, who is your emphasis on week after week, day after day? Is it on us, our ability, positive encouragements, things to keep us going through the week? Or is it always drawing our attention? Do the leaders always draw the attention back to Jesus Christ alone and him crucified? Do they draw you into the glorious Christ? Do they present him before you as glorious Christ, worthy of worship and praise and glory and true in all that he says? I'm not here to call out any one particular question, but as Jesus applied these warnings to the crowds of his day, so it applies to would-be disciples today. Ask these questions sincerely. Follow the answers carefully. My beloved, we can never make too much of Christ Jesus. The Prince of Preachers, Charles Spurgeon, as he was called, his grandfather was called to preach one evening when his grandson was scheduled to preach, when Charles was scheduled to preach, but he was running late. So his grandfather, who himself was a preacher, he stood up and he began to preach. And upon seeing his grandson walk in, he stopped and said to the crowd, "Here comes my grandson. He can preach better than I can, but you cannot preach a better gospel, can you, Charles?" My friends, the primary error of religion is that it tries to preach a better gospel than simply Jesus Christ alone. As the only way, the only truth, the only life. But we cannot preach a better gospel. The glorious Christ. So we must put forth. Follow him. Let's pray.